Hello, everybody. Well, a few months ago, we had a beautiful guest on our show, Shayne. And I'm sure you remember his story, which was very traumatic. Now we're having a follow-up. And in 10 months, so much has changed. We've got a whole new life. And that's the exciting part. So sit back, relax, just put your earbuds on and listen to the story and get some inspiration. Oh, and by the way, Scully's here with us today as well. If you remember, that was a big issue as well in Shayne's life. So let's get to it. Hello, Shayne. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm awesome. Thank you. And how's Scully?
Oh, he couldn't be better. He's living his best life.
He's so cool. He's such a beautiful boy. So tell us how... Just tell us a bit about what happened since the last time we spoke, which was in, I don't know, November, I think. But I know that a lot of congratulations are in order, like 10 months sober.
Yeah. So after we spoke, I moved into a new place. I was still on property at my rehab I went to. But this is a little more long-term. So I can stay there for 2 years. I only have two roommates. So I've been there and things are, I mean, my roommates are great. Things are steady there. And then, I mean, other than work's doing what work does. I mean, it has its ups and its downs. But the most recent thing I did is I bought a car. So I'm not doing public transportation anymore. I got this a week from today. So it's still all fresh and new, and like I don't want to do anything but hang out in it and drive around and stuff.
Congratulations, Shayne. Oh, and I see you even have a sunroof. How cool is that?
Yeah.
That is so cool. So congratulations on that. It's like so many things have changed. So tell us a bit about fears that you've encountered along the way.
I get anxiety a lot with work because I feel pressured because, like I said last time, like a lot of people put their names on the line for me. So, like, I think I'm putting added pressure on myself, which I shouldn't be doing. Mm-hmm. I just want to do a good job, anytime I have questions, I ask, like, I always come to them. I don't hold anything in. But, and they reassure me that, you know, it's a slow process. I talked to my coworkers and they said, you know, the first 6 months was kind of like, it was literally just figuring things out. I've been there 5 months. I've been at work 5 months as of today. So I'm just going through the motions, you know, feeling people out and seeing, you know, you got to deal with a lot of people during their difficult times. And that's been getting better. I've always lived my life like in fear of doing any, I would always procrastinate on everything and just holding it off because if I procrastinate, if I don't do it, there's no way I can do it wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
And like with this car, it was, I had opportunities, like I'd had the money sitting there to buy a car, but I was always scared, you know, what if I buy the wrong one? What if I would, you know, I had opportunities to purchase and I just waited and this kind of fell into my lap. And I've slowly learned that whenever there's something I'm uncomfortable in doing, I should just do it because it usually turns out to be the right thing.
Yes. Yes, I'm sure. And also it's freeing, right?
Because yeah.
If you think about it, it takes so much energy to procrastinate. We don't realize.
Yeah.
Right. Because yeah. you're encountering and then it keeps and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger in your head. And then eventually when you do it, it's like, oh, that was easy. Why didn't I just do it before? So that's a big lesson, right?
Yeah.
How's it made? It's given you a whole lot of freedom, I'm sure, as well. No.
Yeah. Yeah. The car aside, I've just learned to do that with like everything. Like I used to, not call my psychiatrist because I just didn't want to hear what he had to say. And whenever I'm feeling, you know, weird, I'll call him instantly, even though I don't want to. But anytime I have those decisions where I used to just push it off, I tend to do it right away because it's usually the best outcome.
Wow, so that's a huge thing. Beating, for the want of a better word, like overcoming procrastination, right?
Yeah.
That's huge. I think a lot of us suffer from that.
Right.
Because that fear of, maybe it's like a fear of failure, right? A fear of failure.
I would do it in school, just everything. If I was going to be, if there was a good or bad outcome, I just wanted to avoid the bad outcome at all costs, so I just wouldn't do it.
Yes. So your advice to people out there?
I don't know if this is good advice, but like I said earlier, anytime you have you're faced with an uncomfortable decision, just do it. Change is not supposed to be comfortable.
Yes.
There's growth is going to be uncomfortable in all aspects. Like even with this job, I remember when I called Jessica. Shout out Jessica. I called her when I was in the program about 100 days sober, and she told me that they were hiring and everything, and I was scared to submit my application because I didn't want to get rejected. Like, but I just did it, and, you know, it kind of just, I can pinpoint a bunch of different examples of, you know, things that I used to not do where I would just hold it off or push it away just to avoid that rejection or that negative outcome. But 9 times out of 10, it doesn't turn out that way. You're catastrophizing the fear aspect, and usually it doesn't show its face.
It's like we create all these monsters. A lot of times it's all just in our minds, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So close your eyes, take that leap of faith. Okay, I'm saying that figuratively, right? It's all a metaphor, people. Don't just do it physically. Well, that's exciting just on its own. But I'm sure also, like you were saying at work, it must be hard to like see people that you were like mates with before, buddies or whatever, and how they'll come into your life or how you want to help them, but they don't want help. And I mean, how do you deal with things like that? Or they say they're going to make an appointment and they don't pitch, or they say, hey, you know what? You're just lucky. I'm not lucky. Or how do you deal with all those kind of things?
So my caseload, I think I've got 15 or so on my caseload. They've been keeping it small just because I'm still, you know, learning the ropes and everything.
Mm-mm.
Out of those 15, I probably know 4 of them, maybe. Mm-hmm. And they're way easier to talk to because I can talk. I've discussed with my big boss, the lady who actually hired me.
Mm.
I asked her why these people aren't showing up and stuff like that. And I learned that with the people I don't know, I'm a lot more lenient with them. I'm softer with them. I don't, in the people I do know, I can talk to them because I know them. And I'm like, hey, we have to do this. This is how it needs to be done. And I'm a little more, I don't like lay it out on the table with the people I don't know. So I need to be, I can always be polite, but I need to be a little more, you know, stern with the people I don't know and just not leave them to their own devices as much. Because I have had much better success with the people I do know, maybe because it's a two-way street, where it's because they know me and they don't want to like set an appointment, not show up type of deal. But I'm also a lot more straightforward with them.
So it's all about confidence. So you're learning confidence as you're going along and just
right.
dealing with these people all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But that's good. So I'm sure your success rate has increased more and more and more.
Well, because, see, what I'm doing with I help people get jobs. So I'll help with job readiness. You know, I'll help people with their resumes. I've got job leads, interview, mock interviews, clothing, transportation to any work-related stuff. But my main focus now is helping people increase their income via like Social Security, disability, general relief, cash aid, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And Social Security disability is a long process. I've got applications that are ready to submit, but it's taken close to 2 months to get them that ready. So it's a slow build for that.
Yeah, that takes, and you have to be patient with yourself as well, because I'm sure you also think, like, why isn't this happening? Why am I not doing what I'm supposed to be doing, right?
Well, it's like, because if these were my applications and I was doing this, I would have it done in a week, but it's not my stuff. But I have to, like, again, push myself out of the situation. People are different. People are going through different stuff, and I need to, like, learn to accept that. I don't get frustrated. It's just, like, I started to, you know, sit back and understand, even for myself, that this is going to take time with people.
Now, that's also a big learning curve as well, to be able to not get emotionally involved, because I'm sure you want to just, like, help everybody, and that you want them to get to the next level, and everyone works at their own pace. So now I'm going to ask you a, like, contentious issue, but I have to ask you. Have you ever, I mean, you've been sober now for 10 months, right? Have you ever had the urge to drink again?
Not an urge, but I do have moments where, like, my time out here, I made the best of a bad situation. So I had fun, and there are times, because I go by and try to see people and stuff, and I've got friends who, you know, we call them normies, people who can drink like a gentleman and stuff like that. And yeah, do I miss, like, my old life where I would go to, you know, clubs and, you know, just weekend warrior stuff? I wish I could do that, like go out and have a drink and just get back to work on Monday. But for me, I can't. And because that knowing that I can't do that is so instilled in my mind that, I mean, I miss being able to do that stuff, but I've never, like, the urge is not there. Like, I know I can't do it. So, I mean, I'm not fighting that at all. But I reminisce sometimes, yeah.
Oh, so how different is your life now?
Excuse me?
What are you doing now? Like, how different is your life from when we spoke to, like, 2 months ago to now? What's changed, if anything?
I mean, I'm just growing more as a person. I can feel, like, my stability in my mind and how I react to situations, and back to, you know, not procrastinating anymore. Like, I get shit done. For instance, like, I did the whole getting my driver's license thing was a pain in the butt. Like, I went to the DMV, you know, for over the past 2 months, just, you know, every week, just trying to, because I had to deal with stuff back home and get all that taken care of. And I failed the written test the first time. I failed the driving test the first time. So I kept having to go back, and, like, the old me would not. After I failed that written test, I would have laid off. I would have just not gone back for so long because I didn't want to address that failure again. Mm-hmm. Same with the driving test. I remember I failed the driving portion, and I got in the car, and the person who drove with me, he was laughing at me. I mean, it's funny. I'm 33 years old, and I'm failing these simple tests that 16-year-olds are passing. But he was like, well, schedule the next one. So I did. I scheduled it for the very next day. And even that morning, the next morning, there was a part of me that wanted to just not go. I wanted to not do it. I wanted to just go get on the bus, go to work like I did every other day. But, I mean, I took my own advice, and it was uncomfortable. It'd be embarrassing if I failed again. But I went back, and I passed. But just stuff like that. I don't procrastinate anymore. And like you said earlier, it's freeing, like not being a slave to that what if in the back of your head.
So you found freedom somehow, Shane.
Yeah, and I guess it goes, because a lot of my fear was about what other people think. And now I just don't care anymore. And that's freeing in itself. Like, I don't care what people's opinions are about me, and like it, that, and with that, people seem to like me more. I don't know.
It's really funny. Yes, the more you think, well, you know what, this is who I am, accept me for who I am, and you either like me or you don't, right? It is.
Yeah.
It's funny how people suddenly realize, wow, you know what, it's actually nice. You are more likable than when you're saying, oh, please be my friend.
Right, yeah.
So what does the future hold for Shane?
I mean, I'm gonna stay in social services. I love what I'm doing. I mean, the next move is to get my, so I got my teeth back. I got the job. I got stable living. I finally got a car. I also just got approved for a credit card.
Wow,
Got
congratulations.
not secured. So my credit's surprisingly better than I thought it was. My next step is to live back inside with him.
Ah,
So
yes.
that's gonna take some time. I'm not gonna rush it. He, the woman who's watching him, like we have a good relationship and stuff. And it makes it easier on her now that I have, like, I went to her house and picked him up as opposed to her bringing him to me. So, like, my visits with him will be a lot more on my time, and they'll take a load off on her having to drive out to Escondido and stuff like that. But for right now, it's just, I mean, I'm going to be doing, just keep my head down and keep doing what I'm doing. I've got someone in my life I never thought I'd have, which is, that's a whole other ordeal. She was someone I met on the streets, and I don't like tooting my own horn, but we've helped each other through her getting sober and stuff, and it's a really beautiful thing, just seeing possibly what I've done inspire other people, and that in itself is, I mean, it's just a really, really beautiful thing to see someone change their life from out. So now I understand why people who were out there trying to help me, when I see them, they're like, you can see the genuine like joy they of like they're, because a lot of people who've helped me are volunteers or they're working with the population, and they don't see that many success stories. And so now I can see the like genuine happiness they have when they see someone succeed. I mean, that's really, really cool.
Yes. And yes, I wanted to ask you about that, because I saw something on Instagram with the two of you together, and I remember her as well, you know, because obviously from Showers of Blessings, and she's like a totally different person. So how does that make you feel that you're part of that, but because you were connected, I mean, contentiously, you know, on the streets, that's another story, right? But how does it feel that you're actually growing together and you've been a part really of her life, of helping her get clean? Is she out of rehab now?
She is. She's in sober living. I helped her move, or I picked her up and transported her over there. But yeah, our relationship on the streets was chaotic. And when I first got sober, and I was in my program, like we had, on the streets, we had like a we had a connection, but you know, we're in the peak of our addictions. Like it was chaotic. There was no stability. It was love you, hate you type of thing. We were both trying to find ourselves, and I went off and did what I did, and she remained doing what she did, and we had no communication and stuff like that. I mean, little, but I remember talking to my counselor in the program about her and all I ever wanted, I mean, whether I was involved or not, was for her to be happy. And to finally see that is, I mean, it's beautiful. Like, and to know that I had, even like, she's doing the work, she's doing what she's doing, but to know that I have some little effect on her, you know, changing her life, like that, that's, it's humbling, it's cool. Like, it's, the whole thing's just crazy how it all came back around.
I love that. I actually love that story. It's a perfect love story, actually, right?
Yeah.
To think of the way you met and like also all the chaos between you, you know, because obviously you spoke about it and we won't even go down that road. But and how now you are together. Like, so now you're together as a couple, right?
Yeah.
It's so cool. Well, congratulations on that. Wow, Shayne. I mean, like, this is so beautiful. I just love seeing this success story. And of course, you know, when every time I see someone and they go, oh, you know, I haven't seen Shayne around. I said, of course you haven't seen Shayne. This is like, look how awesome he's looking. And they're all going like, oh, cool. I love it. So everyone's so excited because, of course, you were like, you were the favorite, right? And showers of blessings.
Yeah, I felt very loved there. I mean, even in the program, like, you and Chris came and visited me my first month there. Like, I have a strong connection to that place. I still get my hair cut by the lady who cuts hair there. that place helped that. And there were just so many organizations that had a lot to do with getting me to where I am, and just the love and support that everyone's shown. Like, and it's not fake, it's genuine love and support. And that, saying that, people always ask me, like, what keeps me going in the program, what keeps me going today. Like, obviously I'm doing it for myself, but there are external factors. One being, I don't want to let the people who put even the littlest bit of effort into my recovery, I don't want to let them down. Like, if I were to go out and screw all this up, the disappointment in the woman that has been watching my dog for almost a year, like, I couldn't live with that. So Jessica got me the job. Like, I would let so many people down that put, you know, emotion into where I am. Like, I can't do that.
Yeah, it's so funny how people say, you know what, I'm a self-made person, you know, I'm a self-made woman or a self-made man or whatever it is. But you never really are, right? Because there's always external influences. There's always people out there that support you, and even the invisible people support you. And it's like a two-way street. So people support you and you in turn say, okay, I'm going to live my best life for myself, but also for you, in celebration, I guess, in celebration of the opportunity. I'm just saying, I don't know.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And like, so this past Thursday, they did the point in time count in Carlsbad. That's where, you know, volunteers, the homeless outreach team, they go out at 4 a.m. and they count people outside, you know, just to get an idea of the numbers and know where, like, how many people. Like, that sounds bad, but, you know, the higher the number, the more money organizations like mine get to, you know, help people get off the streets. But I participated this year. When a year ago, I remember being counted.
Yes.
So this year I'm out riding, we all meet together, and this will all link to what we were talking about. We all meet together, and there's homeless outreach officers, volunteers, all these people. And I go in and I see two officers that I hadn't seen since my resurrection, whatever you want to call it, that I saw frequently when I was outside. And I went up to them, and I mean, these are officers that are usually to the T, handshakes and stuff. They both came up to me and gave me a big, like a giant bear hug, and told me how proud they were. And it was sincere. Like, they were genuinely happy to see where I had come from in less than a year. And it's stuff like that. Like, these people don't see the success stories all the time. So to see their work, the fruits of their labor, and to see that, you know, sincere smile on their face and, like, actually be proud of, like, what they're doing, it's, like, I can't let those people down. Whether they care or not, in my heart, they do. So, like, there's just a bunch of, you know, external factors going into where I am. So when people say, you're, like, I said, thank you. I went up to the officers and I said, thank you. You know, you guys helped me get, and they said, no, you did the work. I'm not going to, like, rebut that. But in my mind, they had a huge part in it.
Of course. Yes. It's amazing how each little person just adds their own thing and you just meet the right people at the right time. Okay. I have to ask you this question. What did it feel like to be on the other side? So last year you were being counted and woken up in the 4 a.m. Wake up, you have to be counted. This year you were doing the counting. How did it feel to be on the other side?
I mean, it felt good in the sense that I wasn't outside in the cold and I wasn't getting woken up. I woke up at 4 to do it, but there was a sense of pride. They assigned me to my old park that I basically lived at. So I got to walk around where I was sleeping, and I ran into everyone I surveyed was people that I knew. Mm-hmm. I still, like, in those situations, I still feel a little weird, like, seeing them at the 4 in the morning outside cold. That's, like, the worst situation for them. And I'm seeing them like that, like, that doesn't make me feel good. I wish I could help them, but just to know that's like a super fresh reminder of where I came. And so on that side, yeah, it felt good, but it's still weird to me doing that. I did enjoy it. Like, being able to approach people I knew made it easier for them. Like, it wasn't awkward. We would joke and laugh and all that stuff. And I'd be able to give them their gift cards. I got, like, honest answers out of them for the survey. So all that was great. But there's still a little, I don't want people to think that I think that I'm better than them.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of my biggest fears, is I'm not, I would never want them to think that I hold my nose up at them or anything like that. Like, I was one of them. That's still in me. So yeah, it's a mixed emotions.
And I'm sure you would, but I think you're such a model that a lot of people would want to aspire to do what you've done. So hopefully, because I know we have to mention it here, just as a side note, your last show that we did two months ago has hit over 1,000 views, which is amazing, right? And I'm thinking, like, how many people are you impacting without even realizing it, Shayne? And how many people are actually going to turn around and say, hey, you know what? I've had enough of this life. I want something different. So even if by doing these shows, we impact one person, two people, three people, or even, you know, even just one person, it'll make a huge difference, right?
Yeah.
So you must consider yourself a good role model.
Yeah, I mean, I'd hope so. I know in my beginning of getting sober, I would listen to podcasts about people in similar situations. Like, these are like celebrities and stuff, but just those stories of seeing how, just hearing someone talk about how bad it was. And I was your typical homeless alcoholic. I wasn't living in a car, not to diminish that aspect of homelessness, but I was in a park, in a bush, drinking a half a gallon a day. I was as down and out as you could get. So, like, when I say if I can do it, literally anyone can. Yes, a lot of people helped me, and I made a lot of good relationships, but so can other people. Like, that can be done. These people that I developed these bonds with, they're people who are out there trying to help people like me. It's not just me. Like, I just really hope the luck thing doesn't, like, deter people and stuff. Like, people, there are resources out there for people to get help. You just got to be on it and utilize them.
So that now I have to go and be on it, because a lot of times people say, hey, the resources, here are the resources, go and do something with the resources. How do you get around that? Because a lot of times people, I mean, you've been in the streets, you know, like you're tired, especially if you hung over, you're tired, you don't eat properly, you hung over. If someone says to you, here, go and make a call, like, you go, yeah, tomorrow. How do you change that kind of dynamic and say, you know what, I can help you, or stop procrastinating, or without saying it? And without being in your face.
I don't know, because I can't make people do things. I can only give them the advice. Like, and I get it. I get the discouragement and the, you know, say X organization didn't do anything for me, so why would I go to Y and stuff like that. Like, I understand that. I understand being told no or something not working out and getting discouraged. You just got to want it enough, I guess. Like, I don't have an answer for that. I have people come in and they know, like, people that I don't know, somehow they know that I was on the other side of the desk. And they'll ask me, you know, what'd you do? And, I mean, I just tell them, you got to show up to your appointments. These people are out here to help you. But I get the discouragement and thinking that it'll never get better and stuff like that. You just got to do it, I guess.
You've got to want it enough, I guess.
Yeah, you got, like, well, when it comes to, because I've slowly learned that this is my ignorance on, you know, people in general, but I just assume that, you know, 10 out of 10 people living outside had some sort of substance use thing. That's not the case. That was ignorant of me to say. But for those that do, like, I wouldn't be where I am if I didn't get clean. That's just a fact. That wouldn't happen. And the only reason that happened is because I was finally done. You have to be done. If you're not, then your chances are very slim. So for those out there with, you know, dependency issues, like, you just got to be done.
And no one can do that for you. You've got to do it for yourself. You've got to get to the point where enough is enough is enough. It's time to change.
And that is the one thing that I did. I instilled that in my brain that it's over, it's done with. That mixed with everyone else's help was the recipe to my success.
What advice would you give someone? How can they get to a point where, okay, and I know, and I'm giving you this question, it's very hypothetical, so how can someone get to a point where it's like, it's enough? I mean, how did you, not convince, because we know that your significant other was also like, she was down and out. What happened with her? And I mean, you can't speak to about her, I'm saying from your model of the world, not... you can't speak for her, but what happened to just change things?
Well, I know for me, it was, like I said in the last episode, I was getting arrested. Like, I wasn't going to go to jail, and so I did what I had to do to avoid that, and then things just slowly, they slowly changed in me, and I liked the way I was, so I just kept going. I mean, if I had just gotten out of the jail situation and went back out, eventually I was going to go to jail. Like, that was...
Yes, cool.
So, that, I mean, and for her, like, I can't speak for her. Like, she some things happened and she got into her situation, and she, you can tell when she talks that she's done. Like, she, no one wants to sleep outside and be cold and stuff, and like we had our fun and that's over with. But I mean, I can't speak to anyone's bottom. I can't do that, but you have to reach it. It sounds cliche. It is cliche, but like, it's true. Those cliches are said for a reason, because there's truth behind them. Like, you have to hit that bottom and just not want to live like that anymore.
Of course. Yes, I know. That was a terrible question. Sorry. Really quick on this part. Okay, Shayne. Well, what advice would you give to someone who's reached that point where they say enough is enough is enough? Where do they go from here?
Again, I'm going off my situation.
Yes, of course.
If other cities are like the cities that I was associated with, there are resources. They're there. If one doesn't work out, or you don't like the people, like, there are multiple resources. You just have to be consistent and persistent in pursuing, because their jobs are to get people out of our situation, and you just got to be persistent and consistent. Like, you got to show that you want it. I learned that if you put forth 51% of the effort, those places will give 49%. They'll meet you almost halfway, but you have to show that you want it.
Yes.
And people will bend over backwards for you. And at least that was the case for me.
Yes, I love that. What happens if someone wants to, because I know you can help people out with jobs or whatever it is, or you can guide people to different resources. How do people get hold of you if they need help?
So my organization, I don't know if I'm allowed to put them out
okay.
there.
Okay, let's leave it. If we can, we'll put the description.
Yeah.
Or you can actually reach out to me and we can chat.
Yeah.
I can direct you to Shayne or to services. That's probably a better idea.
Yeah, I'll go up the ladder with that.
Yes. It's better to be safe. Sorry about that, Shayne. Put you in the spot again.
That's
advice?
Lawyering. Any advice, what?
Yeah, anything else you want to just tell us before we leave?
I mean, I'm just happy. Like, I sit every morning and like, I'm having my coffee and I just thinking about, like, I'm super proud of myself. I'm really, really proud of myself. Because like I said earlier, I was just as bad as the next guy. Like, I was the person that, you know, people didn't want to talk to. People were scared of, with the stereotypes and stuff. I was that person. I lived in a park. I lived outside. I was dirty. I was cold. I was wet. And just to be where I am now, it's truly something that I never thought I'd see ever again. I'm grateful for everyone who had a hand in where I am. Like, and I try to show that constantly. I try to go by the places and see the people that I'm doing all right. I'm still doing it. And let them know, like, I truly am grateful and appreciative of, you know, them doing what they do. Like, I just drove by one of the officers today and I like stopped and got out and said hey to him, because I'm appreciative of everyone who had, you know, some sort of say into where I am. Like, it feels good to, it just feels good where I am. Like, I don't have any worries anymore. Like, I'm financially stable. I have, you know, love in my life again. Like, I never thought that. and just things are going great.
I love it. I love it. It's like, I love that. It's such a perfect way to end this show. Gratitude. I think gratitude is a big thing to do with it. Oh, thank you so much, Shayne. It's been such an honor to speak to you again. And hello, and Scully, hopefully you'll be with your soul partner soon, right? Look at him. What do you say about this, Scully?
Yeah, this is the first time. I just want to say this is the first time I've been able to drive in a car with him since I drove out here from California or from North Carolina. So, like, yeah, this is cool.
That is so cool. And because I know we spoke about it in the last our last episode, where it was like such a big thing that you couldn't be with him. So now that's the next step. So wow. I'm just like, I'm in awe in all the changes you've done, and I'm so honored and so privileged to have seen you grow through all this. It's such exciting stuff.
Yeah, it things are good. Things are really good.
Thank you. So just from to help your soul, like better and better and better. So the next time we chat, who knows, right?
Beautiful. I'll be 1 year, March 24th.
Wow. So maybe we'll have to do a show on March the 24th just because we can.
Yeah, why not? We'll see where things go.
We will. Thank you, Shayne. Thank you, Scully.
All right.
Thank you for being here. And we will see you soon. And thank you to everyone that's watching. Bye for now.
Bye.
Bye.